This is Miriam Knight from New Consciousness Review, speaking to Paul and Patricia Richards. They're the authors of Wild Attraction, The Energetic Facts of Life and a Ruthlessly Practical Guide to Extraordinary Relationships. Paul, I really liked your take on personal power, and tell us about the analogy with the radio stations.
Oh my gosh. Oh,
that's you've really read this book.
Oh, this is so much fun. Yeah. You know, I expected that to be the very last question I'd ever be asked, but if it isn't my favorite, it's close. The idea that we can talk to people and listen to people and make choice about how we relate to them based on how we relate to our power is fundamental to Wild Attraction and the whole Sente body of work. And what do I mean by relation to power? Well, quite simply, I can make it simple, it's complicated, but we have a list, we talk about people who are powerless or power averse, who the powerlessness, sometimes people temporarily are powerless, but mostly it's choice. And power aversion is an attitude or a choice, and it's really not your emotions, but it's the behaviors that you allow yourself to do, undertake on a moment-to-moment basis vis-a-vis promise and fulfillment. So if you do not promise, or if you make if you fulfill but don't promise, you have no power. If you promise but don't fulfill, you have no power. No change occurs. If you do neither, nothing happens. If you promise and fulfill begrudgingly or reluctantly, you limit your power. So, you know, we're relating to power as an intangible, indescribable thing that's characterized by the presence of a promise, either express or implied, and a specific fulfillment brought about by the mysterious agency within a person that can identify a promise and cause to bring about its fulfillment. So, if a person going up the scale, there are people who are latent power. They have the promise of power. You can see they're going to have power. You can see it's going to come. They're fun to see them. Then you see people who are power neutral. You know, they sort of don't want to hear about power, but they'll accept it, but they don't want to hear about it. And then there are people who are they seek power and they deny it. And we call those, something like, power sought and denied. And then there's sort of their twin, power sought and celebrated. So you get people that are either entangled one way or another with power, and you get, in their worst extension, passive aggression and overt aggression out of those. Then as you get to the top of the channel, just think of it as going up frequencies, frequency band, you get people who have mastery of power, and either are unrestrained in their use of it or are restrained. So you find people that actually amass significant personal power. They can say and bring about, they can describe a fulfillment and bring it about. But people who are ruthless and unrestrained in their use is sort of the dark side of the top of that pyramid. The people that are at the sort of what I'd say the light side, they generally find that they don't use power much. That when you have enough power, you realize it's only there to express awe and gratitude for being on the planet and revealing yourself through the aesthetics of the wide range of aesthetics of human expression, but not to get what you want or shape the future or have your way. So most of the time, the people in that power mastered and restrained category, you rarely see them do anything to impose on the world around them. They getting there usually recognize whatever they did to get that power taught them that something other than themselves has a much better idea of how the world should be shaped. So if you decide or strive to relate in any way along that continuum, you are transmitting effectively on a channel to other people who relate to power in a similar way, or There's a secondary resonance. For instance, the power mastered and restrained has a tremendous resonance to people with potential power. And they'll likely hear that transmission and be drawn either toward you or in some cases away, but they'll definitely be aware of your presence. And all of those down that list, I could chart out in detail
So is this analogous to the masculine-feminine components?
Well, you know, it's part of the same articulation, but I would say it'd be a different chapter in the book.
Mm-hmm. It's more that each female and each male is going to somewhere fall in that continuum. So each person is going to have a relationship to power and be transmitting that out, and who they attract and who they end up dancing with, you know, you can map it basically and say this person has this relationship with power and they're naturally going to gravitate towards someone with this relationship. So it seems like it crosses the genders.
Well, it's crucial because it's the key to who you attract. Mm-hmm. And if you, instead of looking at, you know, your manias or, you know, your obsessions or whatever, if you simply look at what is your attitude toward making a promise and fulfilling it in the daily course of your life, and you start making conscious choices, that's how you choose, ultimately, through some invisible connective process, that's how you choose who you're going to be attracted to and who you're going to draw. That's the predominant way, and that's true in gender, but it's also true, cuts right across every aspect of life.
Of life, yeah. In closing, what would you say is the main ingredient in an extraordinary relationship?
I would say motion.
Motion or emotion?
Motion. Not emotion, motion. That people that have extraordinary relationships, they move. They move in all three realms. When I teach and we look out, people are still. They're sitting next to each other and they're in a little container and they're in their little energy field and there's nothing happening. When we're sitting next to each other, there's something happening, so that my system is engaging with his system. And when I'm walking in front of him, I'm signaling him and he's responding. And there's this back and forth and constantly he'll say, I saw that. And I'll go, yeah, great. And it's this interactive, I'm alive, you're alive, and I'm letting you know I'm alive. And you're letting me know that you're alive. And there's something that happens. It's the delight of being as alive as you can, that is really not very possible to do when you're either energetically and physically still and also emotionally still. So disclosure is a type of stillness or undisclosing, someone who's too silent when they should be, say, offering messages.
So that's the kind of transmitting component of it. But the other person has to be conscious that you're transmitting, right?
Right. It's the back and forth. I think women are looking for men who can respond to nuance. We're secretly, in our heart of hearts, hoping that the person that we're dating or with, that I can give a subtle thing and he will pick up on it. Want them to.
Yeah, hope.
Is this not true? Yeah. And the more they can, the more it escalates. It's like, oh, he got that. Great. It means he's paying attention because we love attention and it's deep attention.
I have to say, if I were answering, I agree with everything you said, and it's completely right. And if I had answered that question, I would have said attention is the central, it's the center. That attention in an italic sense, not like a line of, you know, eye line or concentration. It's real attention, the field of attention that envelops this person. You're enveloping us in a field of attention. You know, you I think have a mastery of attention. And it's something that bathes me. It's like an energy field, and that's what makes the world go round. That's what we can offer each
emotion.
Other.
It is motion. Your attention moves.
So
if
it's
your attention
and motion.
Yeah, if your attention stays still and stays with you, you won't have what we're calling extraordinary. Your attention needs to move.
What's it like to interview us?
It's great fun. And before we go, I just want you to give a plug for your website.
Oh, madame?
www.sentecenter.com. And that's SENTECenter.com.
Great.
Thank you.
It's been an absolute delight, Paul and Patty. I hope we'll have you again soon.
Thank you very much.
It's
really been fun.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.